Good to see everybody.
Amen.
If you would, turn to Galatians chapter 4 is where we'll get kicked off today. And as you're turning there, we've got a lot of different scriptures to go to. So if you got your pen and paper or maybe one of the bulletins to write down on, just get ready for that. I got a lot of different verses to go to. And the reason for that is we're going to be looking at some prophecies of the birth of our Messiah. And I've mentioned it several times on some of our teachings about the quantity of the prophecies in the Old Testament about our Messiah, the birth of our Messiah. And there's, then you have him coming back the second time. There's tons more prophecies about him coming back the second time. Has everybody heard that? And some of our teachings on Wednesday nights and the past Sunday, and then I think it was one of the series from Dr. Jeffries that we did a while back that mentioned it also. There's over 40 different prophecies about him coming as the Messiah that we know of, where he went to the cross and all that. That's his first time coming. Now, the second time he comes back, he's coming back as the king. We see that in Revelation, and there's over 300 and something prophecies that show us that. Now, you can challenge yourself and go back and find each one if you'd like to, but I'm not going to be able to do that for you this morning. So what I'd like to do this morning is just look at four of them, and we're going to look at four prophecies that were actually prophesied and fulfilled. And then I'm going to read the 44 of them. I'm going to just buzz through them. We won't go through. I just want you to see the quantity. Now, one thing to especially mention is that when somebody fulfills a prophecy, that's a big thing. But to fulfill 44 of them is on a whole nother level. Dr. Jeffries, I believe, I'm going to take that from his teaching. It's a good analogy. If one person could fulfill eight prophecies, okay, eight of them, and fulfill them down to the letter, it would be like, here's the value of that. It's like the mathematical value of it. It would be like filling the state of Texas with $2 or the $1 silver coins. You know what a silver coin, if y'all remember, the big coins. If you filled the whole state 2 foot high with silver coins, the whole state of Texas, and you put an X on one of those coins, and you were able to walk out and blindfold it and pick up one coin, and that'd be the one that had the X on it. That would be the equivalent to fulfilling eight prophecies to the letter. But he not only did eight of them, he did 44 of them. And that was coming from one of the sites that I found. I thought there was more than that. I thought it was in the 60s, but the 40s, I mean, it's still a lot, right? Even if you just did the eight, that's just astronomically or mathematically impossible. But Jesus did all these. And you think about that, and I was pondering on these things as I sometimes do, right? Yeah, does anybody ever ponder on things? Think about things. And the thing I thought about, I was like, well, why did he do it like that? Why all the prophecies and why all the authors of the Bible? And then, you know, put a plug in for our Wednesday night study. We got 66 books in the Bible, 39 in the Old Testament, all these different authors. Why would God do it like that? And the only thing that I'm really just thinking about, and I'm like, God, why would you do it like that? He says, I want to make sure that everybody knows that I have complete control of what I'm doing. And I'm like, you know what? That's exactly what we see from the prophecies. We see God's signature, just like that, on creation, on the prophecies about him coming the first time. And man, it's like, well, he did all these, he did like five times more prophecies about him coming the second time. He said, I want to make sure everybody understands that. And I'm like, wow. And then we take a look at the other religions that's out there, just a brief overview of some of the other religions, and you'll find out that most of the occults And these other religions start out with one person, and they wrote everything, and they've had these divine revelations, and they fooled all these people, and they got millions and billions of dollars. We're watching, me and Holly was watching the Scientology documentary about the one lady that got out of it, and I'm like, man, that is ridiculous how they have trapped these people. And it's, man, it, and when you look at it, it's all about that money. Mm-hmm. It's all about the money. And I'm like, you know, the Mormons is kind of like that too. You know, it started out with one guy, had this so-called premonition and vision, and then he built it, and people believed it, and there's more money and more money and more money, and it's all about that. And I thought about it for a minute, and I said, you know, a lot of these false religions started out with one person, and that's all. It's all about them and what they can get, and about. But with Jesus, and with how God did things over thousands of years, it's just, there's no comparison. There's no comparison between the religions of the world and a relationship with Jesus Christ. There's just no comparison. And so if you're trying to seek joy and happiness and fulfillment in your life, there's only one answer that I can give you, and it's through the Messiah, who came over 2,000 years ago through this virgin birth that was prophesied from Genesis chapter 3, right? In verse 15, that's where we see the very first prophecy of a Messiah. And I'm just like, God gives us, he gives mankind everything and then some to believe who he is and what he's done. And just as we see our scripture today, I can guarantee you 100%, and I've never lied to y'all. I've never lied to my family. I might not have told them everything for their protection, right?
That's right.
But I've made it a point not to. And that's very difficult sometimes, you know, because you get in trouble when you tell the truth, right? And a lot of people don't like you very much when you tell them the truth. And then sometimes if you don't say nothing, they get mad about that. Well, how come you don't say nothing? If I do, you're going to be heading out the door. But they get mad about that, right? So anyway, God has told mankind the truth. And the enemies of God, the people that's in this world that don't know God, are just, they hate God because they want to do what they want to do. But anyway, that's to kind of whet your appetite there. And we're going to look at just four prophecies today, because this is the reason for the season of Christmas. This is why we worship and have Christmas. And it's not all about these gifts. We love to give gifts to the children's village, or the ones that need it. And we like to have our family around. But don't forget, never forget the reason why we celebrate it. You know, okay? All right, so let's take a look. Go, you got your place in Galatians. Hold that right there. I'm gonna read this one in Genesis right quick. It's just one verse. And if you're not familiar with this, you need to see it. But it's Genesis 3:15. This is after sin had come in, the temptation, and then they fail. And God is ordering out, issuing out the punishment for going against God. And it gets down to the woman, what she has to pay off or what she has to endure. And it says in verse 15 of chapter 3 in Genesis, "And I will put enmity between you and the woman, and between your seed and her seed. He shall bruise your head, and you shall bruise his heel." Now, of course, he's talking to, you go back to verse 14, you see he's talking to the serpent, but he's actually issuing it out to the woman, right? And he says, your seed and her seed, okay? And you see, if your Bible's like mine, and that'll be capitalized. And it doesn't come out and say, hey, Messiah's going to come through her, but that's what he's saying there. He's saying that, hey, one day there's going to be a virgin-born woman that's going to have a child without a man. It's going to be God's plan there, and it's going to be a virgin-born. And why is that? Well, sin had entered into the world, and if she'd have had it by a man, he had been sinful or had the curse on him also. That's the reason for the virgin birth. Everybody clear on that? Crystal clear, right? And you say, well, how can these things be? Well, they can be like this because God can do anything he wants to do. He created man out of the dust of the ground, right? He made a woman from that rib. He created stuff out of nothing. So, yeah, it's not anything for him to create a man without a man. Right? It's nothing for him to do that. But see, Satan wants to confuse people and make people doubt these things and all these kind of things. But look at Galatians, if you have your spot there in Galatians chapter 4, this is where the prophecy is fulfilled. Okay, very important to see the fulfillment of the prophecy. All right, so Galatians chapter 4, and you look at verse 4, is everybody there? And it says, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son. And you say, well, what was the fullness of time? Well, if you go back, if he was here when Brother Van did his timeline, he had a real big timeline. We were looking at about, what, 4,000 years, plus or minus a few years, according to the dates and stuff back in Genesis from Noah. You know, you go all the way back to Adam, they live so many years, and it's kind of like they stair-stepped. You remember that? And we can kind of see about 4,000 years up until the birth of Christ. And then we did our study in our Wednesday night study. You see how it's 400 years, there's a certain era, 400 years, it's another era. The time of the judges was like 400 years, and it just kind of got. God has documented the time frame, and it was four. So when you look at the fullness of time, that was from Genesis 3:15, the first prophecy, and then all the other prophecies in between there. It's not just the prophetical books that we've been studying. It's you can have prophecies in historical books and the poetic books, because Psalms, a poetic book, has prophecies in Psalms, and we'll look at that in just a minute. But the big prophecies are all in your prophets section, okay? But then what you see, he says, but when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son, born of a woman, born under the law. Well, the law had to come into effect, and you had to have the Israelites, and you had to have that royal bloodline, and you had to have the kings for him to be that king. There's all these things that needed to take place for God to show us who he was. 4,000 years. Wasn't one guy. It was God doing this. And that's why it took 4,000 years to do it. You know what? God's been around forever. So 4,000 years really ain't a whole lot to him. And he's like, I got to convince these people that I am who I said I am. And he said, and he looked at it. I'm just kind of speculating here. But God said, you know, the best way to do it, to make this beautiful tapestry of creation and how I'm going to come into the world, and I'm going to do it in this 4,000-year period. I'm going to make a people. I'm going to make these kings. I'm going to make this, and I'm going to make it go down through the bloodline. And he said, I'm going to do it to where it's perfect. And that's why God did it. But he also did it to where mankind could have a choice in some of the stuff, right? But he's ultimately in control of it. It blows you away if you look at all the different pieces to the puzzle. But God is in complete control of what he wants to do. But yet, he also gives us the freedom to choose him or not to choose him. That's what's even more interesting about the whole thing. Because mankind is really screwing things up. But yet, God still did his plan. And it's almost like, well, hey, I know you're going to mess things up, but it's not going to affect my plan at all. Matter of fact, you're going to be doing things to make my plan succeed even more. God does those things. He'll use the devil to get things done. He'll let the enemy come in to do things that he wants done. And that's kind of crazy, isn't it? But many times we see in the Old Testament, the Israelites would be going against God, and he says, okay, I'm allow the Babylonians to come in and to destroy you. Right? Now, there were times where God allowed a plague to come in because, remember, David, and they had counted the troops and the people and stuff. God told them not to do that, and he went on and done it. And then what happened? David said, man, I don't want to be hurt by the enemy. I don't want this plague or nothing. He said, I'd rather be hit by your hand, and that's what happened. And man, God destroyed a lot of people that day within a 2 to 3 day period, right? We see so many examples, though, of how God can use the situation for his glory. But then sometimes God will step in and do it himself. This is one of them cases where God steps in and does it himself. In that fullness of time, he did that. Then he goes into verse 5 to redeem those who were under the law. That's all the Old Testament, that we might receive the adoption as sons. We couldn't be saved by the law, but we can be saved through the Messiah. We can't be saved from a sacrifice of a bull or a lamb or a goat or a turtle dove or whatever. That only covers the sin, but he is the only one who can take away the sin, right? And that's what he's talking about. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. The Holy Spirit wasn't like that in the Old Testament. The Holy Spirit would come on to like David or different prophets at certain times for specific prophecies or something like that. But in the New Testament, after Jesus went to be with the Father, we see on the day of Pentecost, he sends the Holy Spirit into the world that those prophecies could be fulfilled, that God would be in our hearts. And today, during the church age, we experience that the Holy Spirit is within us. Now, there are times when we can be filled with the Holy Spirit, but not always that we're filled, right? And we see that in Scripture, too. And because you are sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, but a son. And if a son, then an heir to God through Christ. So what he did as the King and the Messiah, he made it he's given mankind the ability to be able to be heirs with God and to also be royalty in that royal family. What an amazing thing. But it wouldn't have been possible unless he had done what he did. It wouldn't have been possible if he wouldn't have said, all right, this is my plan. And he let us in on the plan by the prophecy. He said, this is what I'm going to do. And he did it. Isn't that something to see that? That's one big reason to celebrate Christmas, because God has given us the ability to be a part of his family. If you're a child of God today, you can say, man, that is an awesome thing to understand and to be a part of God's family, isn't it? Yeah, that's great. All right, and so we see the prophecy of Genesis 3:15, the Messiah from the seed of the woman. The second thing I want to show you is the bloodline. Very important to see this. He's a descendant of Abraham. He's a descendant of Isaac, Jacob. And then we see out of that, we see the nation of Israel, because we know how Jacob, his name, and God changes his name to Israel. We see the 12 sons, and you're thinking, well, how come he didn't pick Joseph? Well, he didn't. He picked Judah, because Judah was going to be one of the strongest bloodline. But he chose Judah because he said Jesus is going to come through that bloodline. Okay, and I'm not going to read all these, but if you want to write them down and look them up, you had Genesis 12:3, descendant of Abraham. Isaac, we see Genesis 17:19. Jacob is in Numbers 24:17. But I want you to see this one in Judah. Go to Genesis 49. Genesis 49. And verse 10, and it's just one verse. It says there, the scepter, and a scepter is like it's like a tall cane, right? And it's like that the king carries. It's real big. You ever see them on the movies and stuff like that? The scepter shall not depart from Judah. In other words, the king is going to come through that bloodline. Nor a lawgiver for between his feet until Shiloh comes, and to him, and to Jesus, shall be the obedience of the people. So we see there, and see, if you don't know these prophecies, that's okay. I mean, but there's different places where you can find them through study Bibles and different things like that. There's the prophecy, and it's kind of hidden in a way, right? Because you're like, well, it doesn't really come out and say Jesus, but it's him who he's talking about. Just like Genesis 3:15, it doesn't really come out and say, well, Jesus is going to be this, and this. But when you put everything together, that's when you see it. Okay, it's kind of like a parable almost, but it's a prophecy. some of the prophecies are a lot clearer. Look at let's go to Matthew chapter 1, and you'll see this prophecy that's fulfilled. All right, go to Matthew chapter 1, and you'll see right there, these are all the bloodlines here. The bloodline is very important, and the reason it's important because this is God's people, okay, that God created from a long line of idol worshipers. And Abraham was the first one that he created to that Jewish race, so you know, later called Hebrews, right? And so we see here the book of the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the son of David, very important to see that, the son of Abraham. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. Abraham begot Isaac, Isaac begot Jacob, Jacob begot Judah. You see that? And his brothers. But Judah was the one that was important because that's the line that Jesus comes through. That's the line that was prophesied. And that's the one he comes through. And then verse 17. This is what I really want you to see. This is one of those fingerprints of God. Signature. This is how you can see through the scriptures the signature of God. All the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations. Well, that's kind of cool. From David until the captivity in Babylon are 14 generations. Wait a second. All right, look at this next one. And from the captivity of Babylon until Christ are 14 generations. Just a little side note there to let you know that God's running things. How in the world could it be that perfect to see that? God just wanted to show you that he's in control and he's doing this. Because if it was just left up to mankind, I mean, it'd be all over the board. It'd be like throwing dice and just getting what you get. And no structure, no kind of order. But God, in his divine wisdom throughout everything, has a perfect order. Just like me and Brother Don and Caleb was talking about physics. If you study physics at all, everything in this world has a perfect order, and it doesn't change. Gravity is the same as it was 6,000 years ago. God set things into motion, and it has not changed. Because there's 7 billion people on the planet, yeah, we're tearing things up, right? We collect a lot of garbage. We don't burn it like we used to. But when we see this, I'm like, wow, that's something else to see that. It's just a little side note for you if you've never seen that, to show you that God set it in his perfect design. Now, look to the next thing as we see this Messiah as royalty. We see the bloodline, but let's go a little bit further and we see him as a king, not just as a, we know he's a prophet, priest, and king, but we saw the bloodline. But now let's look at the royal line. All right, go to Isaiah chapter 9 and look at the prophecy. You got to go back to the Old Testament, right? Isaiah is one of the major prophets. There we go, right after Proverbs and all that, if you're struggling on that. Isaiah chapter 9. I didn't mark it, and you know, like with a post-it note, so I could kind of go with you here. Isaiah chapter 9 and verse 6. Everybody ready? Now this one here, you'll hear this a lot at Christmas time, but I wanted to show you this in the prophetic book from Isaiah. He says, chapter 9, verse 6, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be to no end upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice from that time forward, even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." It's going to happen. Now, we know some of it's happened, but see, some of it is to come. Okay? He has not set things in order just yet. We are still dealing with sin on this planet, right? We're still dealing with Satan and the evil. But there's coming a day when he's going to be on the throne and he's going to set things straight. And man, he's going to rule this world. He's going to make it right, though. All right, but look, let's look at the fulfillment to that prophecy. Look at Luke chapter 1. And Luke chapter 1, we see in the Christmas, we call it the Christmas story a lot of times, but Luke chapter 1 and verse 32, I wanted to show you this here. This is the announcement to Mary. If you go back a few verses, where Gabriel's telling her this, and verse 32 says, "He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David." Okay? When he talks about his father David, that's the bloodline, but he's also talking about the royal bloodline. Okay? Even though Jesus has been around for eternity, because we go back to Genesis and we can see that in the scripture, we see him here in the bloodline. Jesus has a lot of different things going on, right? We see him as the Word. We see him as that royal bloodline. We see him as that family in the family of Abraham all the way down. We see him as Messiah, the Savior. There's so many different things. Even in Isaiah spoke about that. But then in verse 34, then Mary said to the angel, "How can this be, since I do not know a man?" The angel answered and said to her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Highest will overshadow you. Therefore, also the Holy One is to be born, will be called the Son of God. Now, indeed, Elizabeth, your relative, has also conceived a son in her old age, and this is now the sixth month for her was called barren, for with God nothing will be impossible." Isn't that something? Nothing will be impossible. And you say, how in the world can I die today and be in heaven right at that with God? All things are possible. Nobody's witnessed that, right? Nobody here has witnessed that effect. But I'm telling you, as soon as the sun came up today and the clouds moved in and the rain's coming down this afternoon, it's supposed to be 100% right today. I'm telling you, just like you're breathing right now and you don't have no control, yeah, you can hold your breath for a little bit, but you're going to have to breathe again or you're going to die, right? I mean, your body's just automatic on some stuff, right? And it's like, man, God's done all these things, all these prophecies, everything is to point to him. And if we just reject all that, I mean, we're missing out on everything, right? We're just missing out on so much if we reject that. And you say, well, I'm not rejecting it. Man, praise God, you're not rejecting what God has set in place. Hey, we just pray for these ones that's not here, the ones that want to reject and say, man, y'all are missing out on so much. You're going to miss out on so much. Now, let's look to the last thing where we see the Messiah anointed and that how he is eternal. Now, we hadn't spoke about the eternal part of the prophecies, but let's look to Psalms 45. Go back to your Old Testament where it was prophesied. Even though Psalms is listed as one of the five poetical books, we see a lot of prophecy in Psalms. We see in chapter 22, we see how the Messiah is crucified in chapter 22. We see him in chapter 23 as that shepherd, the good shepherd, like we see in the New Testament. Then in chapter 24, we see him as the king that returns and sets things right. Man, Psalms is full of prophecies. But in 45, go to Psalms 45. That's why I love chapter 22, man, 23. Man, it's really good to see all that. Chapter 45 and verse 6, "Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness, the scepter of your kingdom." And then he says, "You love righteousness and hate wickedness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions." There's nobody else out there, by the way, that's been anointed to be the Messiah. Nobody. Only Jesus is that Messiah. And if you know him as Lord and Savior, I can guarantee you by the word of God that you're going to be able to see him face to face.
Yes.
And you'll be like, man, I never thought it would be like this. You're looking around in heaven, and you're like, man, I never thought it would be like this. And when he fixes this world, you'll be like, man, I never thought it would be like this. You can look at the beauty of God's work right now, and it has a curse on it right now. So you hadn't seen nothing yet. You have not seen what it can look like. But yet there's beauty even in this cursed world. God left us a good bit of it, right? He left us a lot of it, even though mankind is messing things up on it. But you see the fulfillments in chapter 1 of Hebrews. This will be our last verse that we go to here. But in Hebrews chapter 1, you'll see those same verses there. I just went there and I went too far. I think. Let's see. Yeah, I don't want to go back that way. Yeah, there we go. Okay. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 5. And this is real interesting to see this because we see some more of those same prophecies that were spoken of. So I won't go back over that again. But verses 8 through 12, you'll see some of those same prophecies that were mentioned in Psalms 45. And also Psalms 102 is talking about these here. So I didn't want to repeat those. So if you want to look at the Psalms 102 and verse 25 through 28, it's some of the same one. It's almost to the letter what we're going to look at right now. All right, so Hebrews chapter 1, verse 5, for to which of the angels did he ever say? And it's kind of like a rhetorical question in one way. He says, which one did I tell him this? You are my son, today I have begotten you. He never told an angel that. So Jesus is not an angel. He's the Messiah, the Son of God. And again, I will be to him a father, and he shall be to me a son. And we understand the Trinity, it's the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, right? But they're all one. The best way I've been able, people say, well, I can't explain that. Yes, it's difficult on some levels, but I'm a dad, but I'm also a son, but I'm also a preacher, and I'm also a pastor, and I also, you know, can fix stuff. I mean, I do a lot of different things, but that's on a earthly level, right? With him, you have God the Father that is Spirit, and we worship him in spirit and truth. God the Son, he's the Messiah, and he is one who was crucified for us, 100% man, 100% God. Then we have the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit does the work. He's kind of the in-between guy, and he's working, but all of that is God, right? He's our Creator, Messiah, Savior, Counselor, Healer. Man, he's all kinds of things to us, right? So let's keep going. But when he again brings the firstborn into the world, he says, let all the angels of God worship him, because he is God. And of the angels, he says, who makes his angel spirits and ministers a flame of fire. But to the Son, he says, here's the differentiation. Here's how it's different, how he is different than an angel. Your throne, O God, is forever and ever. Yeah, because he's God. A scepter of righteousness, a scepter for your kingdom. You have loved righteousness, and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness and than your companion. He has been anointed. He has been set aside. He has gone through all the recommendations and prophecies and everything that God has done to be the one, to be the Savior. Nobody else is even in the picture, right? Nobody is nowhere near Jesus on the scale, right? He goes on and says in verse 10, and you, Lord, in the beginning laid the foundation of the earth. Jesus is our Creator, right? He has always been there. Now, 2,000 years ago, he came down as a man, right, and became our Savior. Our minds are it's kind of tough for us to envision. It's like, well, how can these things be? With God, all things are possible. God did this. He says, you, Lord, in the beginning laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will remain. And they will all grow old like a garment, like a cloak. You will fold them up, and they will be changed. God's going to renovate this earth when he comes back. He's going to make it brand new. He's going to lift the curse. He's going to fix everything. Then he says, all will be changed. You are the same and your years will not fail. But to which of the angels has he ever said, sit at my right hand till I make your enemies my footstool? He's not said that to them. Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister to those who will inherit salvation? So the angels have a particular job to do. Jesus has one job. He does a lot of different things, but he's that one. Jesus is Jesus. Mankind has their responsibilities, and then if we say, hey, I want to be a child of God, then we are a slave to the master at that point. We're no longer bound by sin, but we are bound by a new master, right? To do what he wants us to do. So, Christmas is a reason to celebrate our Savior. All right? Let's go a little prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for being our Savior, for being our Christ, for being our Messiah. And just in these few prophecies, we see the handiwork and the signature that you have to show us irrefutable proof that we have a great and mighty God. And Lord, help us during this season to thank you and to be thankful for all that you've done. And when these trials and tribulations and the things of the world creep in on us, help us to just stay positive and say, Lord, you are the reason that we have Christmas. And just be with our families today and during this season. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, thank you all for coming out.